Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Abu Saleh, an assistant professor of English at the Raja Pyarimohan College under University of Calcutta. Now we'll be doing a module on Alexander Pope, and the module is under the paper English Literature 1590 to 1798. The module has been prepared by Sasoto Kusari, who is an assistant professor of English at Government Tehatta Government College under University of Kalyani. Let us move to the module. This module is a modest attempt to make a critical attempt of the study of life and works of Alexander Pope. The objective of this module is to familiarize the students with the life and works of a true genius like Alexander Pope. While doing so, the module also provide a commentary on the contemporary social, cultural, and literary practices. Alexander Pope is described by William J. Long as the poet of a great nation. His fame rests mainly on his accomplishments as a satirist. He was a champion exponent of neoclassical poetic creed that focused on making poetry more rational, scientific, rather than an emotional enterprise. This undisputed genius was born in a Roman Catholic family in the year 1688. His religious adherences did not facilitate his early life, as he grew up in a time when Protestants dominated the contemporary social life. As a result, Pope did not have much chance to pursue formal education. His lack of formal training, as noted by many commentators, is palpable in some of his earlier lesser known works. We are discussing Alexander Pope's life. We find that Pope was very sick and remained very ill most of the time. His physical oddities also made him a butt of jokes. He used satire as a medium of venting out his frustration and anger against those who mocked him. And the religious and physical disadvantages really shaped up Pope's poetic imagination. For the sake of convenience, Pope's literary career may be divided into three phases. The first phase consists of poems such as Pastorals, Winds or Forest, Messiha, Essay on Criticism, and The Rape of the Lock. In the second phase, he devoted much of his time in translating some of the classical works such as the Iliad and the Odyssey. He also joined the Scribblers' Club during this time. In the long third phase, Pope wrote the Epistles and the famous one, the Dunciad. Now, let us discuss early literary life and career of Alexander Pope. Published in 1711, Essay on Criticism is the first significant poem of Pope's literary career. The poem is an attempt to sum up the ideas of Horace, Boileau, and the 18th century classicists. Though written in the early phase, the poem also showcases Pope's command over heroic couplet. We are discussing Essay on Criticism by Alexander Pope. It is the first part on the poem deals with true taste and the relation between art and nature. Pope criticizes those who he feels lack this fine taste. Throughout this section, Pope emphasizes on the value of common sense. While doing so, he also glorifies ancient poets like Homer and Virgil and critics like Aristotle, who epistomize these values. In part 2, Pope shows how imperfect learning can lead to a faulty and prejudiced criticism. Developing his arguments further, Pope lays down some fundamental rules that must be followed by critics. While doing so, he again reveals his admiration for the ancient masters. The poem, however, is known primarily for being a storehouse of critical maxims. Many of the expressions used in the poem have entered our day-to-day use of the language. Some examples are, for fools rush where angels fear to tread. To err is human, to forgive divine. A little learning is a dangerous thing. So we were discussing Alexander Pope's essay on criticism. Now we'll discuss another important and marvelous work of Alexander Pope, which is known as The Rape of the Lock. Another important poem of this phase is The Rape of the Lock that deserves mention. It also perhaps most celebrated poem of Alexander Pope. The poem was first published in the year 1712 and it was divided in two cantos. The revised version of three more cantos was published in 1714. Now let us discuss the background of the poem The Rape of the Lock. Pope wrote this poem when he was living in Binfield. He became friendly with a neighboring Catholic family, the Blounts of Mapplet Durham. One of the cousins of the family was Arabella Fermor, who is presented as Belinda in the poem. One of the distant relatives of the family, Lord Petre, mischievously stole a lock of hair from Belinda's head. This created a gulf between the families. And Pope was requested by John Carroll, a mutual friend of both the families, to write a poem that would make them laugh. Though written on a considerably trivial subject, the poem's tone and language carries a sense of an event of epic proportions. The subject matter is introduced through an invocation. However, the juxtaposition of the serious and the trivial starts from the very beginning. The fifth line, "Slight is the subject, but not so the praise," sets the mood of the poem. There are innumerable examples of mock epic tradition to be found throughout the poem. Out of these, the description of a game of ombre is possibly the most polished example of the genre. The Rape of the Lock easily surpasses its predecessors in the genre, like Dryden MacFlecknoe, which was published in 1678, Boileau's La Lutrine, which was published in 1674, and Garth the Dispensary. Now we'll discuss the supernatural machinery which has been used in the poem The Rape of the Lock. With the second and enlarged version of the poem, Pope introduces the supernatural machinery in the poem. Supernatural machinery is an integral part of any epic poem. Pope seems to project the supernatural in a way that suits his mock heroic style. The primary source of Pope's supernatural machinery was Le Comte de Gabalis, a short novel written by Abbé Montfaucon de Villars. In epic poetry, the supernatural elements, including the god and the goddesses, play a pivotal role by influencing the course of action. However, in Pope's poem, the supernatural elements like sylphs, nymphs, gnomes, and salamanders seem to intensify this parody of the epic. Though Ariel, the chief of the sylphs, has some powers, but they are of no use in the moment of need. The mock heroic structure of the poem, Rape of the Lock, further allows Pope to expose the follies and foibles of contemporary society. Pope satirically comments on customs of the aristocratic society that fail to distinguish between husbands and lapdogs. The projection of Belinda while getting dressed for a class is a classic example of the narcissist attitude of the fashionable people of the age, especially women. However, such projections have drawn flak from the feminist critics, who have found them regressive and misogynist. Pope does not stop after merely critiquing the fashionable men and women. He also satirizes important social systems such as the judiciary. In Canto 2, when the members of the aristocratic society meet, Pope shows them in indulging in narrow-minded gossiping and character assassination. While discussing that, we found the social atmosphere of the time which as Pope was satirizing. Now, we'll discuss the second phase of Alexander Pope, where he was a translator. Though the Rape of the Lock saw the birth of a genius, it was the translations of the ancient classics like the Iliad and the Odyssey that brought Pope into fame and fortune in equal measures. His translation allowed him to move from the humble Binfield, more prosperous Twickenham. The translations were well received, mostly because of the way he interpreted, as William J. Long notes, Homer in the elegant artificial language of his own age. Long further observes how in Pope's translations, Homeric characters lose their strength and became fashionable men of the court. While in the translations may not be very authentic, but they stand as masterful specimen of Pope's use of heroic grandeur that made these translated works entertaining for the people of the time. Another phase of Pope's life is his involvement with the Scribblers Club. Besides being a successful translator, Pope also became the member of the Scribblers Club. The members of the Scribblers Club were Tory intellectuals such as Jonathan Swift, John Gay, Thomas Parnell, John Arbuthnot, and Pope himself. The purpose of this club was to write satires, critiquing the follies and of the contemporary society under the guise of Martin Scribblers. The club was founded in the year 1714 and ended in the year 1746 with the death of the founders. The most reputed of all the members were Jonathan Swift and Alexander Pope. Though active and served, the club did not publish its material until 1741, when the memoirs of Martin Scribblers were published. So, after discussing two phases of Alexander Pope's life, now we'll discuss the third phase of his literary career. In the rest of his literary career, Pope dedicated himself to write moral and satirical pieces like an essay on man, which was published sometime between 1733 to 1734, an epistle to Dr. Arbuthnot in 1735, and obviously the famous one, the Dunciad. This period marks the birth of a more mature, philosophical, and contemplative poet, Alexander Pope. Now, let us discuss Pope's work, An Essay on Man. Beside The Rape of the Lock, An Essay on Man is the best known and the most quoted work of Pope. This work is written to rationalize Milton's famous proclamation at the beginning of Paradise Lost. Pope subverts Milton's famous proclamation, justifies the ways of God to man, and proclaims himself that he wants to vindicate the ways of God to man. However, Pope did not have any specific answer as to how he wanted to vindicate. Hence, he wrote four epistles which were concerning man's relation to the universe, to himself, to society, and to happiness. Like Essay on Criticism, this poem also abounds in wonderful expressions. Some of them are, do good by the stealth and blush not to find it fame. All nature is but art, unknown to thee, all chance direction which thou cannot see. All discord, harmony not understood, all partial evil, universal good. Now we will discuss another important work of Alexander Pope, that is An Epistle to Dr. Arbuthnot. An Epistle to Dr. Arbuthnot is a kind of biographical satirical apologia addressed to his friend John Arbuthnot. When Pope came to know about the ailing health of his friend, he wrote this piece. The poem is undoubtedly his most autobiographical one. Throughout his life, Pope had many rivalries, both personal and, of course, professional. The poem is a defense of his poetic practices and viciously attacks those against whom he had grudges. This poem is famous for satirical character sketches of Atricus, which is of Joseph Addison, and Sporus, which of John Harvey. Addison is presented as a talented but jealous man. John Harvey, on the other hand, is projected as a sexually perverse and a dangerous human being. Another remarkable feature of the poem is its use of heroic couplet. Regarding the masterly use of rhyme scheme in this poem, David Hayes writes, "The heroic couplet is used with a flexibility and a playful, yea deadly wit to a degree not easily found in Pope's earlier work. Though brushed aside by many contemporary critics as a lampoon, it has to be noted the work is undoubtedly one of the best achievements of Pope. Now we'll discuss most important and which was written in the latter phase of Pope's career, that is the Dunciad. The Dunciad was published in various forms from 1728 to 1743. The poem is possibly most sustained satirical work of him. Much like Essay on Criticism, the poem is a dig at the half-witted critics who failed to appreciate his talents. Pope started to conceive this work when Lewis Theobald attacked him in Shakespeare Restored in the year 1726. In his work, Theobald severely criticized Pope for the way he tried to present Shakespeare. Pope, in his preface to Shakespeare, projected the great poet in a way that would suit the contemporary taste. The poem is not organized mock heroic poem like the Rape of the Lock, but there are employments of techniques used in epic poems such as the invocation. For instance, in Book 1, Pope starts with an invocation and often employs language typical of an epic or of mock epic. The poem celebrates the goddesses of dullness and shows how her chosen agents have filled the world with a sense of decay. A sense of doom pervades all through the poem and also ends with the same feeling, as it seems Pope had lost all his hope for civilization. To sum up the module, we can say that Pope was undoubtedly a daunting figure of the neoclassical period. His physical and social problems were not powerful enough to tie him down. He overcame his insecurities with brilliantly written poems, which are cherished even today as great literary achievements. In this module, we came to know about a famous poet, Alexander Pope. Alexander Pope, even though he was physically handicapped, but he managed to write brilliant pieces like the Dunciad, the Rape of the Lock, and other poems and essays. We have listed several of his works and commentaries in the e-text section. If you want to learn more about this module and especially on Alexander Pope and his works, please have a look at the e-text. Also, you can have a look at the further reading section and to know more about Alexander Pope. Further, you can also join in the self-assessment section of this module. Thank you.